morning, everybody. Welcome to our service. There's just one notice that I'd like to mention. Mike sent an extra email notice out yesterday, and on there, one of the things that's happening later today is Delwyn Atwell's testimony service, which you can watch streaming on YouTube live or later if you want to. That's just reminding you of that in case you haven't seen the email yet. And now I'd like to hand over to Irene, who's leading our worship today.
Good morning, everyone. And it's nice to chat and get together again, and it's nice to be with the Lord. So the call to worship this morning is from Psalm 117. Praise the Lord, all you nations, extol him, all you peoples, for great is his love toward us, and the faithfulness of the Lord endures forever. Which is number 25 in Singing the Face. Come, now is the time to worship.
Come, now is the time. As you are to worship, come just as you are before your God. Come.
One day every tongue will confess you are God. One day.
now we will have our Lent liturgy.
Our Lent reflection this year explored the biblical concept of the wilderness. Today, we remember that the wilderness is a dangerous place. In biblical times, it was the haunt of wild animals, outcasts and bandits, and the danger of getting stranded without food and drink was always a possibility. If you had to travel from town to town, the wilderness was unavoidable. And if you were wise, you would travel in convoy. One of the most popular stories that Jesus told takes place on one of these roads. Traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho was difficult and dangerous. There are many places like that in our world.
Kenneth was traveling from London to Leeds when he fell among thieves. They took his rucksack, beat him up, and left him outside the railway station to die. A clergyman passed him as he rushed to catch his train. He saw a drunk lying by the wall and didn't look back. Likewise, the civil servant who passed him on our way to work. A young bearded Muslim stopped to talk to him and quickly realized that this man was in serious trouble. He called an ambulance and stayed with the man until he was sure that he was safely in the care of a hospital, and then went back later to check if he needed anything.
Loving God, the last few months have made us more aware of so many people who need help. We have seen over the last months that we can all help people in need. For even a kind word, an offer of help, a smile can be a sign that somebody cares. As Christians, we know that, like our Lord Jesus, we can share our gifts and love with those who rely on other people to ease their problems. Thank you, Lord, for equipping us to be your servants. Amen.
And we continue with our time of prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, let the things of today be our only concern. Tomorrow will have troubles of its own. You gave us wisdom and strength for everything the day holds. Let us see everything through your eyes. May we love the unlovable. Show patience toward the impatient. Treat the unjust with justice. Show tolerance towards the intolerant and help the helpless. Show us how to maintain the standards you have set for us, and let us not impose those same standards on others, lest we interfere with your plans. Through the day, we ask that you accept our day's worship, whatever it is which we offer, without thought of reward or praise, but because whatever we do is done for you and your glory. Keep us constantly watchful and alert, that we miss no opportunity you put in our path. Make us aware of your continued presence in all situations and in all places. And we do thank you, Lord, for all the good in the world, for homes, families, and love. Thank you for your church and all the loving family we find here. Most of all, thank you for Jesus, our Saviour, and your Holy Spirit at work in our lives. Sometimes we find it hard to count all our blessings because there are so many. But so often we don't remember them. We complain when things are not as we want them to be. We criticise people who disagree with us, and we forget to look for you in all the difficulties of life we are experiencing. And yet we know you are with us as you promised. And sadly, sometimes we agree with the people who hold this world's views, forgetting your teaching, your forgiveness and your love, and watching television or listening to the news and criticizing those who are doing things that really we can't do anything about. Yet in all our failures, we become aware of you. You are with us, ready to forgive and comfort and hold us in your love. So now we turn again to thank you for your patience and mercy, and praise you for your grace and goodness. To you be all glory. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen. And now we have our readings.
The reading today is from John chapter 2, starting at verse 13. It's entitled, Jesus Clears the Temple Courts. When it was almost time for the Jewish Passover, Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In the temple courts, he found people selling cattle, sheep, and doves, and others sitting at tables exchanging money. So he made a whip out of cords and drove all from the temple courts, both sheep and cattle. He scattered the coins of the money changers and overturned their tables. To those who sold doves, he said, "Get these out of here. Stop turning my father's house into a market." His disciples remembered that it is written, "Zeal for your house will consume me." The Jews then responded to him, "What sign can you show us to prove your authority to do all this?" Jesus answered them, "Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days." They replied, "It's taken 46 years to build this temple, and you're going to raise it in 3 days?" But the temple he had spoken of was his body. After he was raised from the dead, his disciples recalled what he had said. Then they believed the scripture and the words that Jesus had spoken. Thanks be to God.
And thank you to all those who read liturgy or listened to prayers. Have you ever been surprised by someone doing something uncharacteristic? I'm sure we all have at some time. But I remember when I was younger, my brother and I were in our room, in our living room, and our mother was with us. And she is quite a gentle person. She doesn't, her way of punishing usually was withdrawing privileges or making us do some tasks she knew we would hate. But this particular day, my brother, who was about 16, I think, and nearly 6 feet tall, said something really cheeky to my mother. And I saw her face and thought, what on earth is she going to do? And she climbed on a dining chair and hit my brother over the ear. Well, there was this stunned silence. The three of us just gaped. And then we all fell about laughing, and my brother helped her down and he apologized for his behavior, and all was well again. So it was quite a little incident, and I won't forget it, I'm sure, for a very long time. But it was so unexpected on my mother's part. We just never thought she could do anything like that. And it all ended amicably. But in our reading, of course, we hear of another incident and the uncharacteristic behavior of Jesus. Jesus, we know as a healer, a comforter, one who put others first, When he was harsh with people, it was verbal. And he usually had patience as well, and only attacked people when he knew that there was a good reason to verbally attack them. Yet in this reading, he makes a whip of cords and he goes into the temple court and did something very unexpected. He scattered it. Can you imagine? There's this court with all these people and he is just in there. I don't know, I found it very difficult when we were taught this years ago, because I thought Jesus wouldn't do that. It's not my idea of Jesus, but it's in scripture and he did it. Now, it's in all four gospels, so it must have made an impact on the disciples and the people who were with him. The temple was constructed in such a way that everyone could worship God. The first court was the court of the Gentiles. And then there were ascending courts for different levels of praise. You go up a flight of steps to the next level, and that's the women's court. And something when I was looking at this, I didn't know before, but in the corner of the women's court, there was placed an area which was quarantine, and it's where people with leprosy could go and worship. They had their own entrance. Amazing, isn't it? They've got this place. They thought of everybody. It was God's house. And then more steps up to the priest's court, which was for Jewish men and boys. Quite strict. And then, of course, the highest point was the sanctuary. And this is where the Holy of Holies was. And only the high priest could go in there, and then only once a year. So it was all carefully planned to worship God. Now imagine you're a pilgrim and you've come for your one of a lifetime visit to the temple. And you get there and you're so excited till you step into that courtyard for Gentiles. How they must have felt, I cannot imagine. It must have been awful. I tried to think what I would do if I walked into a church that was so disrespectful, but it's hard. Because of course, there'd be sacrificial animals making a whole lot of noise and smells and all sorts of things. There would be the altar for the blood sacrifices, attracting flies and all this horribleness. And they would bring gifts. And quite often the gifts were rejected by the stewards because, oh no, sorry, you can't give that. Look, it's got a spot here. No, you can't bring that. It's missing a tail feather. No, you can't bring that because it looks as though it might go lame. They had so many excuses not to accept the gifts that people had brought for sacrifice. And then on top of that, you think, okay, we'll go and buy another sacrifice from here, and they're bound to be okay. But first, you've got to change your money. You think we've got money problems. You've got saved up and brought enough money to get you there and back. And now you've got to buy a gift because they won't accept yours. So you go to the money changers and they say, yes, we'll change your money, but it's a bit like Heathrow Airport. You'll pay more here for it than you do anywhere else on the planet. So they had to change their money. But they would, even if it meant they had a long and perhaps hungry journey home. And it wasn't just the visitors. This happened to Jews as well. And this is the reason that Jesus was so angry and reacted so violently. causing chaos and saying, "How dare you turn my father's house into a market?" Jesus had been sent by his father to restore himself to his people. And he found the Jews, who should be guardians and role models for worship, placing burdens on the people, stopping them from worshiping. The priests carried out their rituals and their duties, while the pilgrims and believers were harassed, cheated, weighed down with rules. Jesus had come to bring his father's love to his brothers and sisters, including us. That was his purpose, to come and share life with people, with humans. He came to save his brothers and sisters, and it was impossible for him to stand by passively while worshippers were treated this way. Now, as one would expect, the Jewish authorities arrived to see what the commotion was about. Must have been quite a din when you think about it, with animals and money changers trying to grovel and get their money back on the table. And oh, so there they were. And the obvious first question was, who gave you authority to do this? Now, that was a perfectly good request, because there had been many messiahs who claimed to be the one and promised great signs to confirm their claims, but they had all failed. But Jesus' reply was even more unexpected. "Destroy this temple, and in 3 days I will raise it again." I think there's a magician, isn't there? I can't remember his name, who does all sorts of things, like make jet planes appear in the streets and things like that. But Jesus was no magician. And they said, "Impossible." It took 46 years to build the temple thus far. And they knew it would take more years of work before it was finally finished. So how could Jesus rebuild it in 3 days? Well, with benefit of hindsight that we have, and of course that John had when he wrote the gospel, Jesus was not referring to the building, the stones, even though they were very beautiful. Because when the Romans destroyed Jerusalem in AD 70, temple worship finished. Because the temple had already been corrupted, was irreverent and formulaic, and God was rejecting its worship. With his resurrection, Jesus would bring true worship based on a relationship with God and a new spiritual temple built of his believers, living stones. The leaders of the temple had made a basic error. They had become proud of their temple. They made an elaborate show of their rituals. They forgot why the temple had been built. It was for the worship of God and to give him glory, but they were worshiping the building and taking the glory for themselves. They forgot the temple was a tool. So perhaps we should beware also as Christians. Of course we want our buildings to be warm and welcoming, and we remember to serve people when and where we can, people like our night shelter guests and other groups who share the church, showing God's love, and many other people appreciate it. But it's here because the people who built it loved the Lord and wanted a place to worship when they moved to a new estate of houses. And they started in a humble builder's hut. That's what church is about. A convenient place to meet as a building, but a group of people who meet to worship and love the Lord. Scholar William Barclay writes, "We have the tremendous truth that our contact with God, our entry into his presence, our approach to God is not dependent on anything that human hands can build or human minds can devise. In the street, in the home, at work, in the road, in the church, we have an inner temple, the temple that is God. Each day we pray that God will guide us to people who want to hear of his love, who need reassurance that they are not deluding themselves and can be sure they are acceptable to God. We need to have boldness to speak out, and it isn't easy. And yet, now more people are coming to listen to God through Zoom and other electronic means. I just pray that when we are out of this pandemic, when we get out into the world again, we'll have the courage to speak with boldness, talk about what has happened during the pandemic, how churches have rallied, and not just churches, other faiths too, have rallied to find new ways to say, we trust God. We will get through this with his help. So, may the Holy Spirit lead us to the people who are waiting to hear that good news. And may we be able to share it and his fellowship with us always. Amen. And now Mary will bring our prayers of intercession.
Eternal One, we come before you together at this moment in time to lift our concerns to you in prayer. So we lift to you those places where pollution is damaging our world. We lift to you those who are struggling to overcome the problems. Those whose lives are affected. And we lift to you the governments who have the ability to make decisions. Lord, may your love for your creation guide us as we examine our lives and the changes that need to be made. We lift to you those places where greed and lust for power and fear hold sway. We lift to you those who are displaced from their homes. Those who have been injured. Those who fight injustice. Help us to support them in any way we can. Through our prayers, through our actions, through our words. And most of all, with our love. We lift to you all those who are struggling with all kinds of ill health. Both physical, mental, and emotional. Pray for your healing. And we lift to you all those who have healing as their calling. We pray that they will have your wisdom and insight to know what each person needs. And at this time of year, when people are at their lowest, we remember those who have lost loved ones. May your love and your presence sustain them in their loss. May they know your strength and your peace in their lives. And we bring these our prayers in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, Mary. And our closing hymn is number 51 in the hymn book. It's Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not, Thy compassions, they fail not. As Thou hast been, Thou forever will be. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, morning by morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed Thy hands hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto sin and a peace that endureth, Thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 besides. Great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, every morning new mercies I see, and all I have needed Thy hands hath provided. Great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, great is Thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me.
May the love of the Father draw us to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen us in his service. Amen. May the joy of the Holy Spirit fill our souls. Amen. And may the blessing of God be with us always. Amen.